Four Pillar Sports, a podcast for sports fans, made by sports fans. Join Chris and Randy every week as they dive deep into football, basketball, baseball, and professional wrestling. Catch Four Pillar Sports on all major platforms. And remember, keep on talking sports.
This is your girl Yannick Taylor, aka Priestess, hostess of Conversations with the Priestess. Here's a preview of what you may hear on Conversations with the Priestess.
We weren't meant for monogamy, let's be honest. Like, we have needs, let's be real. And communicating that, what you want, what you don't want, what sets up.
Now, this drink is brown. Because I learned something. Since I'm older, I can't do brown liquor anymore. Also, I noticed since I started on hormone replacement therapy, HRT, in 2015, me and certain liquors don't mix well. I don't know whether...
And I recognize that a lot of men love to be dominated by women. And that's because men are seen as these leaders, as this big alpha male dominant being. And because they're put on this pedestal of being leaders, sometimes they want to be submissive.
Back when I cosplayed a butch queen in South Carolina around 2011, I was on Craigslist. This is when Craigslist was bumping and before they had gotten rid of the personal section.
I hope you enjoyed that preview. Join me on Wednesdays at 9 p.m. for Priestess After Dark. Full video versions of the podcast can be found on patreon.com/CWTPriestess and join me on Fridays at noon for our regular Friday post. Live, love, and be free. Smooches.
Available on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, YouTube, anywhere you download and stream podcasts.
Avoid legal snags, Jason. I'm telling you right now that you are currently being recorded.
I acknowledge that fact and give you permission to use it as you see fit, but no one else.
I don't want to end up in a legal snag. I heard those are very tough to escape, like Alcatraz. So the Alcatraz of snags.
That's a very understated British way of describing Alcatraz prison. Oh, it's a bit of a snag.
It seems we've... excuse me, Mr. Dustin Hoffman. It seems we've ended up in a bit of a snag. Well, it seems, Mr. Hoffman, we are in Alcatraz.
Oh, well, I'm Dustin Hoffman. This is very silly, but the fact is, folks, we don't have a guest today. I deeply wanted to get a guest. I was looking through my ethereal Rolodex.
Yeah.
To come in, and nobody was answering. I did so many seances over the past week.
Jason, I don't understand. Like, you were, like, that's your only thing I ask you to do, is just book the guests. That's the part of the show. It's under your guidance, and...
I mean, I want to take responsibility. I blame myself. I haven't been feeling great this week. I've had this weird pain kind of inside me, and I'm starting to kind of feel it right now. It's...
Oh, no. Are you okay?
Just give me a second.
Jason?
Hello, Brent.
Oh, no.
You know who it is?
Oh, no!
Say it, Brendan.
It's history's greatest monster, Daniel Day-Lewis.
And I have completed, well, I may have said this the last time I was on, but I have completed now my most perfect performance.
Wait a second. Hold on a second.
Yeah.
Tell me you weren't Jason this whole time. Again.
Well, I mean, when one thinks about what is all of time, but it's been quite a while, I will say. It's been quite amazing. I wasn't always in control, you see, but sometimes I was. I've inhabited his spirit, you see, because I'm dead.
You're dead?
Yes. I didn't want to make a big deal about it. I didn't want to set anybody off. And I didn't want my enemies to know the history's greatest monster had died. But I'm still alive, Brendan, in spirit and in Jason.
So how long have you been Jason again?
Well, what is time to a ghost, Brendan?
Oh, boy.
What is time? Seriously, What is time? I don't know. I'm a ghost. I have no sense of it anymore.
It would take a very long time for me to explain it, Mr. Day-Lewis.
All right. Well, you enjoyed that movie last week I was in, then.
We did, and you were great in it. And now I'm regretting saying all those kind words about you.
Well, I had to do this. I don't intend to stay in this form much longer. I have the entire universe to see. I tell you, being dead has been an exquisite experience. And I fully intend to return and be in a movie. But I wanted to tell you, I found an answer. You want to know? So many people over life have said so many things, but there's only one man that was right. So I highly suggest you check out the writings of L. Ron Hubbard.
Oh, no.
I met him as he was traveling the universe, you see.
No.
And he had a lot of good points, and signed me up for a service where I'm sending some of my inheritance every week, and he's teaching me some things.
No, don't do it. It's a trap.
You might say I'm going up a bridge.
Oh, a bridge too far, Daniel.
But I just wanted you to know, Brendan, I just wanted you to know, personally, that I'm capable of anything. And I want you to just think about that, and I wish you to remain in fear. Do you understand?
I'm terrified of you all the time. All the time.
Good. Then I must depart. I wish you all the best. Good luck. I don't know what happened. Oh, shit. I feel like I was lonely on a long distance run.
Oh, what happened? No. Jason, wait, do you even get the reference you just made, or was that Daniel Day-Lewis?
I don't even know. Where have I been? What day is it?
Oh, my God. What's the last movie you remember watching for this podcast?
Oh, Jesus. It was so long ago. I don't know. Time has no meaning. What was that one? Alec Guinness. He was in a heist.
There was
old ladies. There was old ladies.
The Lady Killers?
Yeah, that must have been it.
Okay. Well, you know what, Jason? I'm going to refresh you on everything, and you're going to be right back to normal.
Stormed the White House. Capitol building.
No, that wasn't that. Well, that was in the deleted scenes.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
I like that part. I must have seen that on YouTube.
Yeah, it was a good British film. But Jason, it's weird that you also had the exact same opinions as Daniel Day-Lewis. Once again, history's greatest monster, dying when we didn't even know he passed away. I didn't even know he was sick, and he took over your body.
But we haven't heard from him, so I mean, he could be dead.
So, Jason, I mean, I'm glad you're back after that terrifying ordeal.
I'm glad to be back. What movie did we watch?
We watched a film. Well, I mean, we need to introduce the podcast first. I'm Brendan.
Okay. I'm Jason.
Thank God. I mean, I really hope you're not still Daniel Day-Lewis. But we never know. And this is a podcast called For Screen.
Andre.
That's right. And on this podcast, we talk about the British Film Institute's top 100 British films of all British time as composed in the British year of 1990 British 9.
Again, as we've said, the only British movies were made prior to 1999. Anything else after is illegal.
Illegal, yes. You were actually hung for making a British movie after 1999. That is why you never hear from Edgar Wright anymore.
That's why we are taking such a risk when we do our Now for Something Completely Similar series and watch illegal, supposedly, allegedly British films.
Well, and that's why we call it that, because we're avoiding a lot of illegalities there.
That's right. Out here in the colonies, law is it's very difficult to find.
Right.
It's chaos. It's anarchy. But we make do.
Anarchy in the UK, you might say.
No, it's anarchy in the colony, in this case.
Okay.
Kanadar.
Kanadar, yes.
Kanadar, as the British like to say.
Kanadar. So, Jason, I want to tell you right now, this is our 70th movie that we're doing off this list. We are 70 deep with this movie.
So you might say this is sort of our Diamond Jubilee.
Yes, you could say that.
Yeah, wow.
And you just did.
I did.
So, but before we talk about this week's film, we have to read some comments from last week's movie, the Merchant Ivory classic, A Room with a View.
A room with a view. A room with a view. A room with a view that you can see out of and get a nice view outside of your room with that view.
A room with a view, Brendan. A movie with some comments.
Comments! Well, Jason, here is your favorite name to say, so I'm going to say it. Our first comment is from Andrew Littlefield.
Ah, our classic commenter.
He says, I love the way it looks. The story is simple but wonderfully told. I only wish that they had the guts to leave in the anti-religious part of the book. Still an excellent adaptation. They had a little bit of anti-religion, right?
Well, it didn't seem like it seemed kind of wry, I suppose.
Questioning religion.
Yeah, or at least, you know, like the priests weren't necessarily treated with the utmost, like, reverence in the film.
So they were, like, bi-religious.
Sure.
Religious. That's curious about
religion. They did show a man of the cloth's wang.
That's pretty pro-religion as far as I'm concerned.
Like our Lord and Savior, I also have a wang.
Listen, if my priest got a dick like that, I'm a Christian.
Here's cheers.
You have a bottle and I have a can. It didn't work.
Thank you, Andrew, as always.
Mm-hmm. And your little field.
Our next comment comes from gold tier, platinum level, top star commenter Sharon Horwat.
Oh, 5 stars.
Absolutely. And Sharon says, I definitely remember watching it, but I don't remember much about it. I do remember loving how snobbishly Daniel Day-Lewis is at points during the movie. Oh, I agree. And also how young all of these actors I love looked at the time. Seriously, Helena Bonham Carter is nearly unrecognizable. Yeah, she's very much ahead of playing Marla. But it's interesting to go back and see somebody. It's cool to have a record of that. Of like, yeah, 18-year-old Helena Bonham Carter, that she has this record of her life and performance.
She looks so young. Like, she almost looks like a child. Yes. Like, she's very close
to that.
Well,
she is, pretty much.
18, I think she was at the time.
Yes. Yeah. Sharon continues, also, and this is the most important part, why penis? I don't care for full frontal anyways, but no penises, please. Thank you. She's very emphatic about that.
No penises. Sharon doesn't want those penises.
Well, so I'm guessing you're not a fan of Forgetting Sarah Marshall, because that has a prominent penis in it. Crying Game. I mean, shit.
Sorry, I prominent penis is
prominent.
My new...
Meaning that, what's his face? Jason...
McLeod.
Nope, Jason, I'm not in that movie.
Jason Segel.
Jason Segel,
but
yeah.
Jason, what I'm saying is prominent penis is my new punk band name.
That's a good name. I wasn't saying that Jason Segel's penis itself was prominent, that he was prominent.
I mean, it is pretty prominent.
I mean, it's right there.
It's pretty big.
But yeah, so avoid that movie and avoid, actually, you might want to take a week off in a couple weeks there, Sharon.
<That's> true.
Because there's some wangs coming your way.
Wangs coming your way!
What's our next comment, Brendan?
Our next comment is from John Milholland.
A newbie, I would say.
A newbie.
I hope.
And he says, good movie, but not my favorite period piece. That would be Barry Lyndon or Dr. Zhivago.
Well, I don't necessarily agree on Zhivago, though I do like it. Barry Lyndon is fantastic.
Never seen it.
It's a weird movie, but it's a slow movie, but it's beautiful.
John goes on to say, I don't think it's aged at all, really. It hasn't aged poorly, but it hasn't gotten better with time either. I think this is mostly because there's no class struggle or gender role struggle like we've seen in Little Women or Portrait of a Lady on Fire. It's really more about Lucy's personal challenge of being true to herself. A solid movie, very well executed.
I like it. Yeah. Thank you, John. Those are some nice words.
Also, Portrait of a Lady on Fire is a movie that I still have to watch because I've heard everyone talk about it from here to the moon and back.
So my question is it a portrait of a lady on fire, or is the portrait of a lady itself on fire?
Neither of those.
Oh.
Nicolas Cage is not in this movie.
Oh. All right. Well, our next comment, another newbie, I would say.
Yeah.
Tanya Nicole writes, It makes me think of Eddie Izzard.
Whereas if the film did any little bit of business in America, as like if the film did, you know, some decent bit of business, then Hollywood would take it, and they'd remake it, and they'd up the budget by $50 million, and it would be called The Room with a View of Hell. Staircase of Satan. Pond of Death. And have people open the door going, you're fucking in here all the time. All the time, you're in here to fucking matches. In here to fucking matches. You're fucking learning and fucking. You don't talk to me that way. You fuck my wife. I am your wife. I say again, you fuck my wife. All right, yes, I fucked your wife. I am your wife and I fucked her. Die, you can't. Fucking matches, I can't get on. Oh no, space monkeys are attacking. A whole new part of the film that wasn't in the original.
All right, next comment, Brendan.
Oh, it's from Julian Oldham, and Julian Oldham says, it's interesting to me how often Merchant and Ivory return to E.M. Forster's novels, presumably because he's one of the greatest novelists when it comes to xenophobia, sexual identity, and repression. Can't imagine why those themes would resonate in 1980s Britain. Julian also says, Forster is an interesting guy, by the way. He almost completely stopped writing fiction after he finished his quote-unquote gay novel, Maurice. The story is that he started having sex instead. My theory is that he was just fed up of not being able to write openly about his sexuality. Whatever the reason, it feels right that Merchant Ivory made a wonderful film adaptation of Maurice once it was fully published.
Thanks, Julian. I'd rather think that he, like, you know, he definitely just was like, you know what, writing is overrated. I'm going to fuck for the rest of my life, and I would respect him for it.
Well, do you remember that the story we told about David Lean telling the composer to go have sex with his wife for a couple of weeks and then come back and write the theme, right?
Yeah.
What if that's like if that guy never came back. He was like, Mr. Lean, you just introduced me to fucking, and it's amazing.
It's great, and I'm having sex with people I want to have sex with, and it's the best.
I thought this thing just peed. And there's white pee.
Why don't they teach you this shit in school?
I believe they do. No, I went to school in Britain. Oh, okay.
You clearly, my boy, you did not go to public school. Oh, yes, we were all quite abused.
Sad story.
Yeah, it's quite sad. Ashley Westmoreland, on a happier note.
Ashley Westmoreland.
Westmoreland. Why don't I say Westmoreland? We literally have a bridge in this town called the Westmoreland Bridge.
Wow, way to give away our location.
I mean, we've literally said it before on this podcast.
Pretty sure I've said my home phone number on this podcast.
Well,
before.
I don't know about that, but I don't remember that.
I'm sure I have.
I don't know your home phone number.
Keep it in the show.
It's just in my phone.
Keep it in the show.
So Ashley Westmoreland of the Westmoreland's Men, which may have been a company of playwrights with Shakespeare, or I'm just remembering a Harry Turtledove book. It is perfect, she says. I have quoted this movie my entire life, and I've watched it more times than I can count. It continues to be just as enjoyable to watch as ever. I credit it for not allowing myself to settle romantically. I took the weird and offbeat path and have never regretted it. Wow, Ashley, that's awesome. I'm so glad. In all my life, I would never have imagined that somebody would, like, grab this movie, which is a perfectly fine movie, but that this movie would be their movie. That's amazing. I love that. I love that anybody can love anything.
Everything will resonate with someone, I think.
That's right. She quotes this movie like I quote...
Pootie Tang.
Yeah, Pootie Tang. Well, I don't know. Monty Python, maybe. I do quote Simpsons really is my main quote source.
Snake Eyes.
But Snake Eyes. I can't remember a quote from Snake Eyes, except for... What was the guy's name? Michael...
Kevin Dunn.
Kevin Dunn, that's it. Kevin Dunn, fuck you, Kevin Dunn.
And the fact that there was literal blood money. okay, so Vivienne Timmons says, it's pretty perfect. Helena Bonham Carter is a wonderful Lucy Honeychurch. It was my idea of perfect romance as a young girl, with Rupert Graves being my first film crush and my first glance of a penis
as
well.
Oh my.
The music was particularly magical.
So for Vivian, this movie's like Hackers was for me, like getting my glimpse of Angelina Jolie's bosom.
So for Vivian and Sharon, I don't think they'd be film buddies.
No.
Vivian is excited about her first glance of a penis. Sharon is like, enough penis.
You just wait a couple weeks, Vivian. We've got a treat for you.
That sounds horrible.
Remember, this is an audio podcast, so don't think too bad
about the movies that we're talking about.
We're talking about.
Jason and I are not getting naked for anyone that listens to this podcast, unless you sign up today, patreon.com.
Yeah, check out our OnlyFans. That's where the nudes are. OnlyFans. That's only where they go.
Nudes of us and the stars from the movies we talked about.
Our next comment, poor person that comes next, Ruby Tanaka. Ruby Tanaka says, not my favorite Merchant Ivory film, and the two leads are the weakest actors in the cast, but it's still worth a watch. Half-hearted endorsement from Ruby Tanaka. Thank you, Ruby.
That's one of the two hot takes I've got here.
Yeah. We got one more hot take.
It's from Kate, initials MB.
Oh, mysterious.
And Kate says, I love it, but Helena is terrible, and her paramour not any better. But I don't care because it's beautiful and the rest of the cast superb. Honestly, has any film ever been carried by such beauty and supporting cast brilliance before or since?
Oh, well.
I actually think, you know, this reminds me kind of like how good the supporting cast, and the lead, really, was in that Sense and Sensibility movie we watched. Because, yes. I mean, you had Emma Thompson, Alan Rickman, Kate Winslet.
And I haven't seen it in probably 20 years, but Gosford Park has a pretty good supporting cast.
Mm. I mean, that whole movie is a supporting cast.
Yeah. Exactly.
I don't think there's a lead.
That's right. That's what I'm saying. It's all supporting cast.
That's a great fucking movie.
Yeah. I mean, I think it was. Like I say, it's been 20 years.
It's a movie that I remember I was at the age where I was like, I'm going to watch that fucking movie. Yeah. And then I watched it like a year ago.
Were you still working in the theater at the time?
2001? No.
No. No, you were just a
I was just a I was
young lad.
4 years old. Okay, moving on.
He wasn't.
That's all the comments
on the movie. Room with a View. I'm surprised how many people saw it and had reactions to it.
There's a lot of people. Yeah. A lot of people. I had to narrow it down.
Well, we know Eddie Izzard talked about it. Did this come up? Did you mention to me this came up somewhere else? Were we talking about that? Did Room with a View come up with something?
Yes, Jason. The way it came up was you actually retweeted someone who had said that Room of the View was their sexual awakening.
Yeah, Guy Branum, who is a British comedian and is very funny, and I highly recommend you check him out. He's on a lot of British panel shows, but yeah, he said that Room of the View was a fundamental part of his burgeoning sexuality. Sexuality? Was a part of his burgeoning sexuality at a young age?
I found out I was a homosexual.
I was the same piece of furniture I was.
All I wanted is other pieces of furniture to rub up against my front butt.
But specifically other sexuals. But yeah, and then of course our dumb... I had to, of course, ask him if Women in Love figured into that, because, I mean, of the greatest scene of two men bonding that we have seen, I think, in the course
the
of
the only
our
good part
movies.
Of that movie.
Yeah, so yeah, what else is going on?
So, what are you looking at? 90s stand-up comedian in front of a brick wall set?
Oh, yeah, what else is going on? What's in the news? Oh, God, hi, guys. Oh, no, and look, it was President Clinton. Oh, yeah.
What do you think Bugs Bunny would say about that? Okay, Dave Coulier, get off stage.
Cut it out.
We're going to compare this movie, Jason, to the American Film Institute Top 100, because this movie is number 73.
Ooh. On is the it BFI possible Top 100. I've seen this movie. Let's see.
Maybe. Number 73 on the AFI Top 100 is Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid.
That's a Western, too, isn't it?
Yeah, sort of.
I haven't seen that one. That's a Robert Redford and
Paul Newman,
yeah. What a cast. Yeah. Heard that. Then that was a big success. That was a huge movie when it came out, wasn't it?
Yes. And also, I believe the first time is the movie that Raindrops Are Falling on My Head was written for.
Wow. That's cool.
So, unfortunately, Jason has declared that they lose by default.
I like that I'm going to have seen more British movies than American movies. Well, at least
on
the
top
100. Yeah, the good ones.
Yeah. Okay, so I have seen it. Room of the View.
I feel like Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid would be more up my alley, just based on what I know of it. It's like a heist movie, isn't it?
Yeah, kind of. I wouldn't call it a heist movie, honestly.
A crime spree movie?
It's more of a Panic Room remake.
Oh. A remake.
I'm actually going to give it to Room of the View, honestly. Butch Cassidy and Sundance Kids is a fun movie, and the structure is really interesting. It's really good, but I also really liked... Nope, this is the first. I'm canceling my decision.
Oh.
Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid takes this one.
So it's a squeaker.
It's a squeaker.
Tight
like a tiger.
That's right.
But now, Jason, we need to sing our way into everyone's hearts, because we need to talk about The Commitments.
Ow, baby. Every man wanna know
If you want a little loving, you gotta start little slow. She's gonna love you tonight now, if you just treat her right now. Oh, squeeze her real jump, gotta make her feel good. Tell her that you love her, oh, I can know you should. Cause if you don't treat her right now, she won't love you tonight now. If you practice my method.
That's right. That rollicking little intro there means we are talking about a 1991 release called The Commitments, which is number 38 on this list. A very Irish film, Jason.
Aye. 'Tis very Irish in the best possible ways.
Oh, 'tis very Irish. And I will say this just before we get going, not to spoil any other opinions, because Jason and I have made a pact, by the way, a little behind the scenes right now. We are not going to talk to each other about our opinions on the movie before we get into this recording. I feel like that will be, it'll make for more of a fun atmosphere, because we don't know.
We never went deep. We just have quick words.
We had quick words. Sometimes it's mostly me that fucked it up. But I do want to.
You're just so excited. You're an excited boy, and we love you for that.
I get excited. I got really excited over Peeping Tom, and I was like, you better like this fucking movie, Jason.
He threatened me. Thankfully, I liked it.
Thankfully. Under duress, but I'm sure he actually liked it. So this movie, what I wanted to know before we even get started, we've had Steven Izzy on the show a few times, right?
Sure, yes. Yeah, Steven Izzy, the greatest.
This is Izzy's, I think, one of her favorite movies.
Wow.
She told me that's that, nice. So there you go. We'll lay that out.
Before we watched this, the only bit I knew about this movie was from my DVD collecting days, because I remember when this was released on DVD, it was quite a big deal that there was a nice version of this out and available now. So I've been interested to see it, but I was a little bit surprised, because I always thought this was ultimately a punk movie. I thought that this had like a real like punk vibe to it. Like I thought, oh, The Commitments and the cover and everything, it made me think this is gonna be a movie about punk music, but it's not, Brendan. It's not about punk music.
No, it's not at all. And it, by the way, before we even get into the movie, this is directed by Alan Parker, who has made some very interesting movies. Different movies. So he just to name a few, Alan Parker has directed Midnight Express.
Okay.
Fame.
Wow.
Pink Floyd, The Wall.
Nice. Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Angel Heart. The Mickey Rourke, Robert De Niro film about the devil.
Okay. Oh, okay.
By the way, yeah, Robert De Niro plays a character named Louis Cipher. who does he play?
You don't want to watch the movie to find out.
He also directed Mississippi Burning, which I actually just saw for the first time very recently.
Jimmy Woods, right?
No, that's Willem Dafoe and Gene Hackman.
What movie am I thinking of?
I don't know. No idea. Evita, Angela's Ashes, and of course the movie that everyone won't shut up about in 2021, The Life of David Gale.
Wow, that's a broad selection of movies. You got to say that guy.
Crazy, yeah.
He bounced around. Good for him.
He did bounce around. But this is The Commitments, and I'm going to run down some of the cast. Odds are, guys, you've never heard of most of these people, and that's okay. But I'm going to run them down anyway, because there are a lot of strong performers in this movie, and I feel like everyone deserves some credit right off the bat. So we got leading this movie, we got Robert Arkins as Jimmy Rabbit. He is our main character. He is a guy who wants to be a manager. He wants to put together a soul band. We have Angeline Ball as Imelda, the hot little blonde number who everyone has their sights on.
Everyone.
Yeah.
Everyone.
Maria Doyle as Natalie Murphy, another lady who joins the group and has somewhat, for a while at least, unrequited feelings for Jimmy.
Mm-hmm.
Dave Finnegan as Micka Wallace, who probably is it's one of my favorite parts of this movie because he's fucking insane.
Yes.
Bronagh Gallagher as Bernie, who is the third, rounding out the three female characters, the backup singers, but they also get some songs of their own. I just want to say that. Glen Hansard is one of the two people I knew from this movie. He plays Outspan Foster. And the only reason I know him is because he's in the movie Once. That became a big little bit of an indie darling when it came out in 2002, I believe. Another performance in this movie that I really, really like, and this is Johnny Murphy as Joey the Lips Fagan.
Great performance, yes.
amazing performance. And then the third one, that the third standout for me is Andrew Strong as Deco Cuff, who's the lead singer in the band. We also have the only other name I knew from this movie, which is Colm Meaney as Mr. Rabbit, Jimmy's dad.
There he is, the chief.
The Elvis Presley obsessed Mr. Rabbit.
So let's just talk about this briefly. First off,
yeah, we should talk about the plot because there's there's a lot of characters here.
Well, we'll talk about the plot in a sec. I just want to say I believe this movie is all movies that feature Colm Meaney are not, because Colm Meaney doesn't exist. What we are seeing is a record of Chief O'Brien and his adventures in holodecks. And this was one of his holodeck adventures when he was serving on the Enterprise D. He would go into this simulation and this whole story would play out, and he just played this Elvis obsessed dad, and it allowed him to relax and stuff. And he really liked all those boring sorts of just like hang out and be a dad programs until he went to Deep Space Nine and he met Dr. Julian Bashir. And Julian Bashir was like, well, this is really boring. Why don't we like fly in the Battle of Britain or fight like Klingon battles and shit? And he was like, okay.
So now that Jason has explained something that I'm sure a lot of listeners understood but went completely over my head, let's get into the commitments and talk about this movie. Running in the plot, it's a very simple plot.
Very simple.
It is about a man, like you said, Jimmy Rabbit. He wants to. What I thought was interesting in this movie is that he doesn't want to be a singer. He doesn't want to form a band to be in a band. He wants to manage a band, put a band together.
And he does all the heavy lifting. He puts the ad, the paper, he gets everybody together. It's his project, even though he's not actually going to play in it or sing or anything.
Right, exactly. So he wants to put a band together, and basically it's the story of a band coming together and their rise, and surprisingly to me anyway, their fall. But we'll get into it. Jason, this movie is kind of unique right away because I think most of these people did have a little bit of acting experience.
Yes.
But Alan Parker, the director, went completely out of his way to make sure that he was hiring mostly on the basis of local musicians that he could find. He wasn't trying to go for names. Obviously, Colm Meaney, I mean, we know Colm Meaney, but I don't know if he was really a name in 1991.
So, I mean, maybe in Ireland, he would have been probably a more well-known actor, but, you know, in certainly on this side of the pond, unless you were watching Star Trek TNG when this movie came out, which was 1991, you probably didn't know who he was.
Okay, so maybe people knew who he was. He was a recognizable face, perhaps.
Sure.
But, so most of the people in this movie are singers that he went to clubs and just, you know, did interviews with and auditioned with. And actually what's interesting is, we'll get into all these characters, but the guy who plays Micah, who probably has one of my favorite lines, and there are so many good lines in this movie, but one of my favorite lines in this movie is when he's testing out the microphone and he's just bashing it against his own head. He's like, this is a bloody good microphone, this. And apparently when Alan Parker met with him, he knew this guy needed to play a psycho, and he was intentionally like pissing him off. Like he had a very acrimonious like meeting with him, and the guy that played him, that played Micah Wallace, was like, oh man, I definitely didn't get the part because I freaked out at this director. Like Dave Finnegan is his name. He's like, I freaked out at this director and I lost my temper. Like, there's no way in hell I'm gonna be in this movie. And immediately after that meeting, Alan Parker was like, look, I just want to apologize, but you're in because I wanted to see how you would react if somebody was pissing you off, and you're absolutely perfect.
And yeah, that character in the movie is basically sort of a security guard at first. Like, he's kind of like watching the door and dealing with like hecklers and stuff. But eventually he ends up filling in as drummer once the drummer quits the band.
Right. Yeah. They're like, he's a psych. Everyone says he's a psycho. And then we have Jimmy saying, but he's going to be our psycho.
Mm-hmm.
Right. You want to have them on your side.
That's right. And with what you said about the casting that they like interviewed musicians and stuff, it shows, because like that's the thing about this movie is all these people look like real people. Like, they're not, you know, starlets. They're not actors that have been built in a laboratory. They are real Irish people.
And I think that's what confused me about this movie initially because I have the DVD. I bought the DVD. I fell into that trap of like, oh, this looks like a sweet DVD. I'll probably watch this movie one day.
Yeah.
What confused me about the cast list, when I remember when I first saw it, I was like, oh, is this a documentary? Oh, maybe I'll never watch it. That's what I thought. Just seeing the people that were in this movie, I was like, oh, this is about a real band. Like, I don't know if I'm into this. So
now you know. Now you know.
I know. Yeah, and it's just, I don't know, it's just interesting getting going for singers and guiding their performances more, like guiding their, like their acting performances more, rather than getting actors and just having people, like, you know, dub the singers. Actually, the only person in this movie that doesn't play his own instrument is Johnny Murphy, the guy who plays Joey the Lips Fagan, which is, I think that's a hilarious detail, real life detail based on who his character is.
Yeah.
Like that his character tells tall tales and that actor is the only one that doesn't play his own instrument.
Well, also the tall tales thing. Well, we can get into that, but I was confused on that. I wasn't sure. I wasn't exactly sure. But then we had that moment at the end with Wilson Pickett coming by. So I don't know.
Yeah, no. I think it's a great detail. There's so much to get into. First off, this movie reminded me a lot of The Full Monty.
Yeah,
that setting, right?
It's a very working class kind of setting where we're in Dublin. You know, working class kind of place. You know, maybe not in the best shape, but there's, you know, lots of people around. And yeah, definitely, it feels a bit depressed. And, you know, and of course, this is in 1991 when the Troubles are still going on. So in addition to whatever else bad stuff is happening, there is the threat of terrorist attack on a regular basis. So that affects people's morale. So I see where you're coming from with that comparison.
Yeah, well, I think, too, just the idea of the comedy combined with that, because to me, I don't know about you, but to me, this is, I wasn't sure going in if this was a comedy or a drama. To me, this is a comedy.
Like, yeah.
There's dramatic stuff, but I feel like this is more of a comedy.
Yeah. This is based on a book.
Yeah.
And I was reading up a little bit about the book, and apparently the book is pretty much a straight comedy, and it's weirdly written too. Apparently it's written almost all in dialogue.
Yeah. I was reading about that. I remember seeing that as well.
Yeah. And it's part of a trilogy of books, which there were two movies made after this, and Colm is in both them. So that's kind of neat, too.
Yeah, so that was like the Barrytown trilogy. So there's one called The Van, and I forget what the other one is called.
Snapper.
Yeah. And Colm is in all three, but I think he plays different characters in some of them.
I think he's the same character in all three of them, except they changed the character's name in the third one to Larry for some reason.
Sure, I mean... Eventually, you got to be a Larry.
Yeah.
I think that was why the Three Stooges broke up, because Mo was like, I want to be Larry.
And Larry was like, but I'm Larry.
And et cetera.
Fucking
guys, Mo. We just told you. We just revealed it. How the Three Stooges broke up on this podcast.
Quick story. I heard, I think it was J.J. Abrams on a podcast once talk about how he used to call up. He was really interested in comedy. Well, no, maybe it was either J.J. Abrams or maybe it was Judd Apatow. But anyways, one of them got in contact with fucking Larry Fine and at like a home or something and talked to him one day. And he's was talking to him. And he said, oh, you want to talk to Mo? I got his number. I'll give it to you. And he's like, OK. So he calls up Mo and Mo's like, how'd you get this number? And he's like, he says, oh, Larry Fine gave it to me. And there's a pause and he just goes, Larry. I love that he would just do it just to fuck with him after all these years. Anyways, that's enough about the Stooges.
Still crazy after all these years.
Yeah.
Yeah, so, I mean, yeah, Full Monty. And also brassed off a little bit.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, this movie is more... What's the... I was thinking of a different one. It's almost like a heist movie in some ways in that it's like, you know, a good chunk of it is getting the band together. Like, literally getting the band together, you know. And it's like Mass Effect. It's like you're going out, you're getting the new characters, you're doing their loyalty missions to get them in, and then once they're us all together, then we can do the band thing, which is less important than the journey to get there.
Right. Actually, now that you talk about getting the band together, maybe this is the first clip I want to play. Just a little montage of Jimmy having people come in and tell him who their influences are, and he kind of decides right then and there if he wants to even bring them in for an audition. And it's interesting... I take this as the movie slagging all the people that are mentioned here, all the famous people that are mentioned here. So let's take a listen to this little montage.
Who are your influences?
Barry Manilow.
Who are your influences?
Joan Baez, Joni Mitchell.
Wings.
Mike Mantona, Overdrive.
Bandau Ballet, Soft Cell,
Sinead O'Connor.
Bob Benson, I trip to a candy shop where...
Hi, I've come about the audition.
Led Zeppelin.
Billy and the Bollocks.
You too?
What a coward. He doesn't even want to try somebody who looks weird.
Yeah, that detail is weird. At first I was like, oh, is that like a homophobic kind of scene? Because there's one character who definitely is like a Boy George type look to him.
Yes.
And he immediately slams the door in his face. But to be fair, he also does that to someone else after that.
Also, and I'm sure this will be a bigger issue we'll talk about, but are there no black people in Ireland? Simply
None.
Because
no, they are the soul black music. People. They are well,
the black people of Europe, certainly, as they say.
Yeah, the speech goes, we're going to play soul music because we're the Ireland is the blacks of Europe and Dublin are the blacks of Ireland and North Dubliners are the blacks of Dublin.
Yeah, so interesting perspective on that. But it's funny because, yeah, they're doing soul music and the only person of color who shows up in this movie is when they're watching James Brown on TV.
Yes, that's right. But I think the movie kind of comments on that too, right? Because we have a character addressing that early on saying like, aren't we a little white to do this music?
Yes. Yes. He specifically says that, which I thought was really funny. But, you know, they do their best.
Yeah. I do like, so we see this town in kind of ruins because, I mean, it's North Dublin in 1991. It was not a good shape. Like you said, the troubles were even going on at the time still. So there was constant threat of terrorist attacks. He had this sharp divide between North and South Dublin. He even says in the movie at one point, like in his little advertisement, South Dubliners and rednecks need not apply. Because I read up a little bit on it because I don't know a lot about this era, but apparently South Dublin is like the rich, like elite side. They're like Donald Trump's army over here. And then you got the nice little North Dubliners trying to make ends meet.
All the working class people just trying to get by.
Right, exactly. And yeah, so there's a sharp divide there. And like you mentioned, the IRA was doing their shit at the time. I mean, we talked about a movie that kind of took place around the same era, which was The Crying Game.
Sure.
Right? So, I mean, we got a lot of
less music in that one.
I mean, a little bit less.
There was that one song.
But it's a good song, so.
despite mentioning that, this movie does not try to ham-fistedly force in any like IRA stuff or terrorism, or it's in the background because that's when this movie took place.
No, and I mean, I say the full Monty and Brastoff earlier because I think those movies are more of like issue movies, like they push the issue a little bit, but they do it well.
All those movies are about working class people in kind of desperate situations and finding solace in music. And now, obviously, in this one, Jimmy's trying to like make this a thing. He wants to make a go of this and make some money with this admittedly huge band, which is going to cut into his profit margins quite a bit because he has to have 150 people on stage at any given time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's giant. It's a giant band. I do like how after this, like, montage of all, you know, people saying who their influences are, he goes through like a few auditions. I think the audition scenes are really funny too, where he has like he has everything from like people doing a cappella to like a punk singer to a hilarious detail with Colm Meaney is that he loves Elvis Presley. So they have this one singer singing about like Elvis was a Cajun and he went to Memphis later. And then, you know, you have Colm Meaney being like, Elvis was not a Cajun. That's blasphemy.
We had that moment too later where he meets Joey and he talks about hanging out with Elvis. And he's like, did Elvis ever mess around with drugs? And he's like, never saw it. And he's like, I told you.
We need to play that clip at some point. I don't know if you want to play it now, but we need
may
to
as well.
Hear
Let's
that.
Play it. I want to hear
All
it.
All right.
Yeah.
Well, maybe we should talk. Okay. We'll just play the. We should set this up a little bit, maybe first, though. Because we need to kind of understand who Joey is.
So, in the course of the movie, they get all these different members for the band, and they end up. Joey the Lips shows up on his moped to see about being in the band, and he plays trumpet. And he tells Jimmy that he's basically Blues Brothers is him. He's on a mission from God, and God wants him to be in this band, or at least a preacher in Harlem told him that he should spread soul in England. So he took that to heart, and that's his holy mission, is to spread soul to the English.
And he is about 20 years older than everyone else in the band.
Yeah, he's kind of a creepy old guy for sure.
I mean, He is, but I kind of like, I thought he was kind of charming. Like, I thought there was a genuineness to him.
Yes.
Even though there's a definite part of him that's not genuine, maybe, we're not sure. But I think there's still a genuineness to him because he talks about like, oh, I jammed with this musician. Oh, I played with the Beatles. There's a hilarious scene where they're listening to, what's that song? I want to say Blues Brothers, but obviously they're not the original recordist, but the one that's like, you know what I'm talking about?
Yeah. The opening, like, Blues Brothers
looking
music.
For a fox. Looking for a fox. And he says, oh, that's me on trumpet. And then they actually look on the album and it says Jay Fagan. And they're like, but that could be anybody. That could be another Jay Fagan. Maybe that's not even his name. Like, you know what I mean?
Yeah, exactly. They're doubting him.
So in the course of this, he tells this story to Colm Meaney about meeting Elvis. And I think the scene is fantastic. So let's just play this.
Jesus, that's amazing. You were actually in Graceland. So anyway, here's the four of you sitting in the front room of the mansion.
Now, Vernon wasn't drinking lemonade, if you know what I'm saying.
Who's Vernon?
Elvis's da. Vernon Presley. Go on, Joey.
He picked up Gina. Gina's my trumpet. And he puked right into her.
He didn't.
Right into her.
Good Jesus.
So I went back upstairs. I said, yo, Elvis, my man, look what your daddy's after down to my trumpet, and who's going to pay to get her clean?
Tell us.
So,
get out! I said get out! So what did Elvis say, Joey?
Yeah, listen to this. This bit's brilliant. The man said nothing at first. But he took Gina very gently, and he brought her into the bathroom. And he run her under the tap. Then he took out his handkerchief and he gave her a good wipe. And he handed her back to me and he said, Joey the Lips, please forgive my daddy.
Jay. Tell me something, Joey. In all the time that you were in Graceland, Did you ever see Elvis messing around with drugs?
No, brother.
I knew it. I always said, and you malignant little bastard. I knew it.
By God almighty.
I love that scene so much because they tie in Joey the Lips' like inclination to tell tall tales with Colmini's love of Elvis, that he's just like, did Elvis use drugs? No, brother. it's such a great scene.
It made him so happy.
Yeah, it made him so happy. It's almost like, so I feel like Joey is there to tell people what they want to hear, right?
To some extent. If he is indeed a flim-flam artist, and it's still not totally clear to me whether he is or not. He sure sounds like he's exaggerating because he loves name dropping all these people, but he's also, the character can play the trumpet very well. And as we see later in the movie, Wilson Pickett shows up, but late.
Well, I mean, I have a theory about that. I have a theory that could go either way, but we'll wait till we get to that a little later. But I do want to talk about Joey Fagan as a character because I think he's the most interesting character in this entire movie.
Yeah, and he's a character that looks a little different in 2020.
Oh, in 2021. In terms of how he sleeps around?
Well, no, not just that he sleeps around. It's that he comes around, he gets in with this band of younger people, and then he proceeds to work his way through each of the backup singers over the course of it. Now, in the book, I believe, based on the quick review of the summary that I read, he impregnates one of the girls.
Oh.
Or at least there's a pregnancy scare anyways. And I think Imelda, and he just takes off. And that's why he goes away at the end of the book.
Okay, so I'm going to say this right now. I'm really glad that's not in this movie.
No.
Because the character to me, and I don't know if this is because of Johnny Murphy's performance or if this is the way the character's written, but the character of Joey the Lips Fagan seems like not so much of an aggressive guy who's pursuing these girls. I think they're just falling for him.
Yeah, he's got that, you know, that mysterious musician kind of aura to him, and he's got all these stories to tell, which are certainly enchanting and charming to these young ladies.
And another addition to his charm is his mother, right? the character of his mother, because he lives with his mother, or when he comes back to Ireland, he lives with his mother, and his mother is so like, oh yes, you know, he goes to Ireland, or he goes to America. He went to America for 4 years and he played with all these artists. And there's a great little scene where she's like, but I know his secret. And they all kind of lean in, cause they're like, well, what's going on? We want to know more about this guy. And she says, he sends me a postcard all the time.
every place he plays, he sends me a postcard.
And like, I love the relationship between, like, even though we never see them on screen together, which is interesting, like Joey Fagan and his mother. Well, I mean, we kind of do, but not really. Like, I just love that relationship that he goes home because he says his ma's not feeling well.
Which sounds like a made up excuse, right?
I mean, it could be, but I do think it's kind of adorable, that relationship that they have.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah. Sweet. Yeah.
Sort of sweet man as he's having sex with these women a third his age.
Okay, well, let's talk about that then, if we're going to get into this character. He ends up seducing all the females in the band.
Well, he gets caught snogging with Natalie on the stairs after he was sent out to get burgers.
Which is such a 90s thing.
Yeah, go get us burgers. And then that results in Deco? Is that his name, the lead singer?
Yes.
Yeah, because they're talking about them like having snogging with each other or doing whatever. And he's like, oh, well, he's into it. And he's like, oh, maybe she's into it too. Oh, well, then she's a slut. And then fucking Bernie hits him and knocks him off the piano onto the ground. And that was a rightful hit.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. And I mean, that's the thing, too. They say, like, oh, you know, he must be, at one point a character says, well, he must be dipping his dick in steroids to hook up with all these ladies. And I mean, the guy is older, but he's like in his 40s. He's not a 70-year-old man. I do like when he first shows up, too. Jimmy notes, you know, you're about as old as my dad. He says, yes, but I'm 15 years younger than B.B. King. I jammed with him once.
You got to shove it in there.
Yeah. As does he with all the females in the movie.
Yo. And then he had that weird one where he's fucking Bernie. And he does the... What song is it?
Shaft.
It's Shaft. Yeah, he does the opening narration to Shaft just before he plunges his shaft into her.
Well, and then she says, would you shut up and just fuck me, basically.
Yeah.
But my question, I guess, is with Joey Fagan, played by Johnny Murphy, who, again, I think is like... one of my two favorite performances in this movie. But I think what's interesting is, do you think he's like making up, do you think he feels inadequate? Do you think he went to America and he actually never had the success, and he's like making up for it by, like, you know, being with younger women? I don't know.
Or his best days are behind him and he's trying to recapture that. By like telling all these stories and also trying to fuck younger women to remind him of a time when groupies were like, hot and cold running water.
And I mean, we should stress younger women is not like, you know, 20 in their 20s, not illegal.
Well, this was 30 years ago, Brendan.
No, the actresses are clearly not like 50.
No, the actresses, but I'm saying the character, I think the character's been around the block. I think he and Jimmy Page may have hung out.
Oh, no.
Yeah.
It also feels like if he's telling these stories about being in America and jamming with all these people, I mean, maybe it's to make his mom feel good too.
Yeah, he does seem like a guy who likes to bring joy to people around him. And telling these stories, he gives people a little thrill, you know, that little bit of name drop celebrity shit.
I mean, arguably, he's the only character that doesn't cause drama in terms of like getting into fights with people, right? He's always there to kind of bring everyone back together.
Yeah, no, really the only drama he ends up causing is when he says he'll get Wilson Pickett, and then Wilson Pickett doesn't show up.
Right, that is the crux of the final act of this movie. I guess then I will say my other favorite character, in terms of the most interesting, and I mean, I'm sure you can just guess, is Deco.
Deco. Because when we initially meet Deco, he's at a wedding, and he is... hammered drunk, just belting out a song on stage, and then eventually is so drunk that he falls over into the crowd and knocks over a bunch of shit. And typical drunk wedding shit, you know.
Yeah, and Jimmy immediately is like, you know what? That guy's got some pipes.
He's having such trouble finding a singer that it's like, hey, let's give this guy a shot. Sure, he's a drunk wedding guy. And when he goes to see him initially, he even says, he's like, oh yeah, you were singing at the wedding. And he goes, was I? I was like 14 drinks deep. I don't know what the hell was going on.
Yeah, he says, I had 14 rum and blacks. Can you tell me what a rum and black is?
No, but I can consult with the Oracle that's called Google and find out. I wonder if it's a type of, unless it's just rum and coke.
Yeah, because I was wondering. I was like, what the hell is a rum and black?
Let's see. A rum and black drink recipe is 1 ounce of dark rum and 3 ounces of black currant juice.
Don't know what
that might be. All right, that'd be pretty tasty. Yeah, it's like a black currants are like a little like fruit that grows on like a bush.
Okay,
it'd be pretty good, I bet.
So rum and juice, he was basically drinking 14 of them.
Yeah, a lot of them.
What I think is interesting about this character is that if in any other movie, this like in a mainstream movie, this would be about a huge band, right? This would be about a band achieving superstar level fandom. And this guy being this, because he turns into a huge egomaniac.
Yeah.
But it would be more, you'd be more like, oh, okay, I get it. In this movie, they achieve like some fame, like some local fame, but his level of I'm this big star seems higher than it should be.
I don't think he turned into a dick so much as it just exacerbated the dickishness that was already there.
Yes, yes, that's what I want. Yes, that's what I want to focus on because exactly because I think that's what happens with a lot of fame, right? It doesn't necessarily transform you into a different person, but that thing that's just bubbling below the surface for him just pops through, right? It's like, oh yeah, this is me for real.
Well, and I also get the sense from his personality too. He's kind of a dick. Like he's kind of got this very outgoing personality, but he also is kind of mean sometimes and. Yep. Doesn't have a lot of respect for women, but also, to be fair to him, most of them don't seem to have a whole lot of respect for women, like in a more modern sense, because they're literally like a Tex Avery cartoon sometimes. You know, their eyes are almost bugging out of their head when the girls are climbing over the fence down the ladder, and they're like, oh, look, oh, maybe we can see her ass. Oh, it's like those kids, what was that Scottish movie we watched with the kids watching the nurse in the window?
Gregory's Girl.
Gregory's Girl, yeah. They're like grown-up, or more grown-up version of Gregory's Girl. Also, I wanted to mention for a sec the drummer, the redheaded drummer.
Oh, Billy.
Yeah, if people know me, they might think he's my dad, even though he looks nothing like my dad, just because he's got red hair like I used to. And
I love how you were like, guys, you all know my dad, right?
Yeah, well, you know my dad.
You know, it's not Billy.
It's not Billy. No, I can understand why you might think that. My dad doesn't look like him. But the thing they do share in common, besides the fact that he kind of looks like me with the red hair, is that he's a farrier. He shoes horses for a living, which is what my dad has done for 30 years. He hasn't done it recently, but that was his career. So that was a weird. And then later in the movie, they after everything goes down and they ask what happened to Billy, he says that Billy... Billy went back to shoeing horses and he got kicked in the head. It was the best thing that ever happened to him.
Yeah, Billy really gets the short shrift in this movie.
Yeah.
He also hates Deco. Like, I think this is the character that is most at odds with Deco. Because if we get a little bit of background on Billy, the drummer, is that he went to jail, or he's on probation because he basically says, like, you know, I punched some asshole just like Deco.
Yeah.
And I'm on probation now because of it. That's why he quits the band later.
That is, and really, that is the most responsible decision I would say made in the movie, is that he's like, no, I know I'm going to fuck this guy up and I'm going to go to jail because of it. So I have to leave the band because I want to continue living my life and making a living.
But you know what, Jason, we're talking about Deco, and we're talking about Billy, and we're talking about the band. We should actually hear the band sing a little bit.
Yeah, let's hear some of the soul they bring it to.
Let's hear some of the soul. Let's hear a good version of this because they start off kind of shitty. And I will say that it must be so difficult for good singers to pretend like they're shitty singers.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right. I mean, that seems like difficult acting to me.
It's like the actor that pretends to be a bad actor, or the stand up that pretends to do bad stand up. It's a very,
It's like Seth Rogen in Funny People when he's pretending to be shitty at stand up at the beginning of the movie.
And then conversely, you see somebody like Tim Heidecker or Andy Daly that can do that sort of thing and just make it so much, just so funny, and how unfunny it is.
Oh yeah. What else?
Yeah.
All right. So let's listen to a little bit of the band performing at their peak here. Guess you better slow than Mustang down. Mustang Sally, my baby. Yeah, so it's I mean, at that point, they're already like, that's towards kind of the end of the movie, so they're already getting a lot better. But I mean, it's believable that they become a very good band. And I think that's difficult. For some reason, Jason, I don't know why I was thinking about this movie, but this is a movie based on like a fictional band, right?
Yeah.
So all I could think of was that horrible movie Rockstar with Mark Wahlberg.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
And just how unconvincing that movie was in portraying like a band, and how convincing this one was at portraying people coming together and forming this band, and that you believe them, you believe the performances, you believe that they're like building up and building up and building up, and you believe like the tension behind the scenes as well.
Well, I mean, if they all are actually musicians, that makes sense. It always feels more real when you have real musicians. I mean, and you could look at like Spinal Tap is a good example. The three main guys in that all played instruments and wrote that music, or A School of Rock, where all those kids played music, and it again felt so genuine. So I appreciate that.
I
appreciate that the director went to that extent.
I mean, let's not discount Rockstar. Mark Wahlberg is also a musician. Let's not forget that.
That's yes, I suppose technically yes.
He's got a funky bunch,
an entire funky bunch that I don't think made a single appearance in that movie.
How many people are in a funky bunch? Like, what's the conversion there?
That's the great thing about a funky bunch, is that you don't ever have to say how many people specifically. I feel like it'd have to be at least three to be considered a bunch. But okay, after that, the sky's the limit.
and a funky bunch, I think, indicates you have to have a lot more diversity than the real funky bunch probably has.
Yes, absolutely. And certainly we understand why maybe there's no Vietnamese people in the funky bunch, but
I fucking set you up for that because I knew you were gonna comment on that, and I let it happen, so thank
but,
you.
Also, if Mark Wahlberg ever, or Wahlberg, if Mark Wahlberg ever runs Wahlberg for office as a politician, I believe his supporters will be members of the funky bunch at that point. The funky bunch will expand to include all supporters of his platform.
I mean, I hope he never runs for office.
No, me too. But if it happens, funky bunch. How you doing, funky bunch? Say hello to your mothers for me.
Yeah. Oh man. The movie also, I will say, like you mentioned how, you know, Joey sleeps his way through the three female singers in the group.
Works his way through.
What's that?
He churns through them. He grinds through one after the other.
He does. I mean, Imelda, the blonde lady, is suggested, but implied, but we don't know. But I mean, we know.
Well, and we know that every other guy in this band is ready to just ravish that girl at the drop of a hat.
Oh, man. I was going to say, I do appreciate the fact that this movie takes a pretty hard stance that these guys are all like kind of assholes when it comes to that.
Yeah, absolutely. It's pretty clear.
Yeah.
Joey's like the nicest one. And I guess he's the nicest one, but he's also the only one that gets any action. So.
Oh, Joey? Yeah. Well, maybe that's their statement, too. Maybe that's a statement on the part of the movie. It's like, well, this is the only guy not being an overly misogynist pig.
And he's nice and he's smart and he has good stories and he's mature.
Yeah.
Because they're all a bunch of overgrown boys, ultimately.
Ultimately, yes. And this is one of those movies where I would say, I mean, I wrestled with this a little bit because I would argue the first hour and maybe 20 minutes, there's a lot of story going on. There's music in it. There's obviously a lot of music too, but there's some story worked in. And I would say the last like 30 to 40 minutes is almost all music.
Yeah, and it's right? good music too.
It's great music. I'm not going to say it's not, but it's interesting to me that it almost becomes almost all music.
Yeah. Well, people love music, Brendan, and if you really want to make a fan favorite movie, you got to have a lot of music.
I've got a question for you, Jason.
Ask away.
There's a scene where they're on a train, okay? Mm. And, you know, we're going to hear it, but Jimmy is basically giving them this speech. Like, they're getting ready. They haven't performed yet as a group. They've auditioned, or that not auditioned, but they've rehearsed. And he's giving them this speech about soul music a little bit. And they all of a sudden break into song. And I just want to play this scene and maybe talk about what movie comes to mind when you hear this. Because I thought of one.
Are you sure they're on a train? I thought they were on a bus.
No, I'm pretty sure they're on a train because you see the tracks. Like, they cut to an external shot or exterior shot.
Right, because they're going across the bridge. I gotcha.
Yeah. So I just want to play this scene, and then maybe we'll kind of figure out what this movie. I think a movie that maybe took this scene. But anyway, we'll talk about it. Let's listen.
From now on, I don't want you listening to Guns N' Roses and the Soup Dragons. I want you on a strict diet of soul. James Brown for the growls, Otis Redding for the moans, Smokey Robinson for the whines, and Aretha for the whole lot put together.
Jimmy says soul sex.
Dirty bastard.
I didn't say that. I said the rhythm of soul is the rhythm of riding.
You mean you wanted to sing as if you were riding with someone?
You can practice with me.
I'd bite your buttocks while you come near me, a spice.
Might fancy that.
Or make earrings out of your...
Soul is the rhythm of sex, and it's the rhythm of the factory too. The working man's rhythm. Sex in the factory.
Not in the factory I meant. There isn't much rhythm in gutting fish.
Soul is the music that people understand. Sure, it's basic and it's simple, but it's something else, something special. Cause it's honest, that's it, it's honest. There's no fucking bullshit. It sticks its neck out and says it straight from the heart. Sure, there's lots of music you can get off of, but soul is more than that. It takes you somewhere else. It grabs you by the balls and lifts you above the shite.
Said to the man at the railroad station, I want a ticket just for one. He said, well, if you insist, but where you want to go,
so I guess what I'm asking, Jason, is did Cameron Crowe watch this movie?
Well, I think that, yes, absolutely. He must have, because this does remind me certainly of the Tiny Dancer scene in that movie.
Yes, thank you for that very economical answer.
Yeah, I mean, you know, Cameron Crowe, he's a music guy. He likes movies. I feel like he probably saw this movie at some point, and fair to say that he may have been inspired to do that scene from this film. Scene.
thank you. It's like you were like, Brendan, did I say what you wanted me to say? Thank you. Good night and good luck. No, I mean,
I served my purpose.
I don't know. Did you feel that like while watching it? Because I felt that while watching it.
It's funny. It didn't actually occur to me specifically that it was Almost Famous, but watching it, I was like, this feels like I've seen this before somewhere, or at least something similar to this. And I wasn't sure whether they stole it from someone or somebody stole it from them, but
I mean, it could have been before this too, but the first thing I thought of, ladies and gentlemen, if you haven't seen Almost Famous, number one, watch it because it's a
please.
Great movie.
It's so good.
But there's a scene in that movie where they're on the tour bus and they all start slowly breaking into song and singing Tiny Dancer by Elton John. That's kind of what happens in this scene. They start singing Destination Anywhere.
Although, is the implication that he just starts singing it or that they can hear the music that we can hear?
Well, that's my question, too. I mean, that's also the question I have in Almost Famous, right? Because you kind of hear it in the background, too.
but it's almost like I think in Almost Famous, they actually start at the beginning of the song, you know, somebody says,
Fuji, baby.
But in this one, it's like, I feel like the song's already been playing through like his entire speech. So it's like this dude just jumps into the middle of the song and starts singing it and everybody picks it up.
Yeah.
Strange.
Well, I don't think it's playing through the speakers on this train.
Yeah, well, that's what I'm wondering. Was it diegetic music? Did somebody have a boombox we didn't see?
Somebody call Martin Scorsese. We need an answer.
That's right. Get over here, Marty. You and all your brows.
I don't know. I'm also Woody Allen. I don't know what's going on.
That's a movie I want to see, Marty and Woody.
In a buddy cop movie?
Yeah, where Marty's just like, I don't know why I ever agreed to do this. This can't be good for my career.
No, I don't want to be a buddy with this cop.
But we're just going to go to the house. So we're going to arrest the criminals. Everything will be fine. Look, I don't want to work with you, Wood. Can I call you Wood?
Were you surprised, too, in this movie where, like, they go through, like, if this was, like, a biopic of a real band, like, I wouldn't be surprised. Because they go through the same kind of tribulations, right? But the one thing they kind of leave out is they don't really go through, like, a drug problem.
Yeah, no, it's just as you were saying that did occur to me. Yeah, no, nobody really is into drugs in this movie. I think they're all Irish, so alcohol, come on.
But even then, did any of them really have like a drinking problem? Like, I don't think so.
No more than anybody else does, which is everybody. But yeah, no, there's, and also you have to understand too, these people are working class people. They may not have the money for drugs. I don't know that crack cocaine had made it to Dublin by 1991. I'm not sure.
I mean, there is that great reference to drugs in this movie where when he's auditioning people to be in the band, a guy comes up and says, like, what are you? He says, oh, what do you play? And he says, well, I played football. And he's like, no, but what instrument? And he's like, oh, I don't play an instrument. I saw a bunch of people lined up and I thought you were selling drugs.
Yeah, that's a good line.
Also, did you know there's an interesting cameo in this movie? And I looked it up because I was like, this guy has to be something, because the scene was kind of weird. But when he's auditioning people and there's a kid with a skateboard that shows up,
and
you know, Jimmy yells out, oh, well, just start singing in the street then, I'll start auditioning right now. And he's like, well, I can't sing in the street. And of course Jimmy sends him away and he's like, okay, thanks. That kid has a little bit of fame. That kid's name is Peter Rowan, and he is at the time of the movie's production, he had appeared on the cover art of two U2 albums, Boy and War, and he was also a national skating champion.
Oh, that explains why he goes away on a skateboard.
Yeah. I thought that was kind of cool. I wonder if that's the movie's like cute little nod to like having this kid who, I'm assuming if he was on the cover of two U2 albums, people knew his face at that time.
It must have to some extent. There was what I thought was a cameo in this movie, but it wasn't, I don't think. Okay. At the very beginning, I swore up and down that at the beginning of this movie, at the wedding, you see an old man who tells a kid to fuck off. And yes. I was convinced that was Peter Vaughn, who we will remember from Zulu Dawn, but also from Game of Thrones. But I looked it up, and unless it was an uncredited cameo, it is not him.
The old man who, by the way, at the wedding at the beginning of the film, has his legs stuck out. The kid trips over it, and then he wakes up and tells him to fuck off.
Yeah.
I'll say this to you right now. Did you know that the Joey the Lips Fagan was originally going to be played by Van Morrison?
Oh, really? Wow.
How do you think that would have turned out? I don't think that would have been as good.
Yeah, well,
with a recognizable face like that,
the movie wouldn't have got finished because they all would have gotten sick.
Well, apparently Van Morrison met with Alan Parker and they did not have a very friendly meeting. They didn't get along super well. But
he wasn't trying to draw that out of him. He wasn't trying to see how aggressive he would be.
No, not for Joey the Lips. That would be a weird character meeting. But apparently Van Morrison was like, listen, I don't think this is for me, but if you want to use any of my songs, feel free. And I don't think he does.
Morrison doesn't sing soul music.
No, I don't believe there's a scene where Joey the Lips is like, Brad Hat Girl.
I played with Van Morrison, I did. I liked when the dude with the fiddle came in and he started playing the fiddle and then all the girls in the house started doing like Irish step dancing.
Oh, for the audition scene? Yeah.
Yeah, it made me laugh.
Apparently Alan Parker even said when he went to go audition people, he would stop. So they would be traveling down the streets of Dublin. He would stop and see kids busking, and he would stop kids busking and call them into audition. Like that's how much that's how much realism he was going after. Because he also wanted musicians that were very, very talented, because he wanted them so talented that they could pretend to be bad at the beginning of the film. And, you know, gradually show that they're improving. So it's a difficult thing to do when you're a talented musician.
Although I will say there is a big jump in quality from the very first time we hear the backup singers sing to the very next time they sing. They go from just sounding like a bunch of regular people trying to sing to like backup singers in one scene.
I do think that, yeah, I mean, that's the challenge of a movie, right?
Yeah, I mean, obviously, like, you know, it's the scope. And you could sit there and, like, write it and film it so that it was a much more subtler transition, but what would really be gained? Nothing other than me going, oh, that was really cool.
You know, we talked about the father being obsessed with Elvis. I do want to play a scene of him singing Elvis, because this, for me, is like, you put this song in a movie, and I'm in. I'm 100% in. Let's just play this brief bit.
Listen, Jimmy, I have more things to be doing than ironing shorts for you every day of the week. There's more people in the house, you know.
Hey, what's this? What's what? Have you got soul? If so, the world's hardest working band is looking for you. Contact Jay Rabbit. Rednecks and Southsiders need not apply.
Oh, shit. World's hardest working band. There's not someone about it.
Here, where are you going? You haven't finished your dinner.
Out. Can I borrow your hair dryer?
Go and shut.
And leave my aftershave alone.
Who is that at the door?
Some snotty-nosed young fellow with a mouth organ.
You put an ad in the paper.
I'm putting a band together.
Do you need a singer? Wise men say only fools rush in, but I can't help falling in love with you like the river flows.
Elvis is not so.
Elvis is God.
I never pictured God with a fat gut and a corset singing my way at Caesar's Palace.
Jesus,
don't upset your father.
Love that. Yeah, no, any movie that features the song Only Fools Rush In, like, I mean, The Conjuring, I think it was like The Conjuring 1 or 2, there's a scene where Patrick Wilson just sits down and starts singing it to these kids, and I'm like, five-star movie.
Isn't there a whole movie called Only Fools Rush In?
Oh, Fools Rush In with Matthew Perry?
Yeah, sure, that's the one. Can't like say a romantic comedy?
Can't say I've seen it, but if that song's in the movie, it could be five stars. Okay, so we need to talk about the ending of this movie, because the ending of this movie, they're building up their fame. They're, you know, they're getting these gigs. They're doing very well. Jimmy does have a run-in with a black market salesman who is coming after the rest of his money, because doesn't he buy like a piano from him or something?
I think he buys a bunch of equipment from my assumption is that this guy is a fence, that he buys stolen equipment and sells it to other people, so he is trying to get a hold of the stuff they need to be a band, and he kind of gives them £50 up front and then fronts them the rest.
Right. And then to get drums, he gives like an antique that his mother owns to like as like collateral, which he clearly has never paid off. But no, when he goes through that, the guy shows up at the club and like attacks him and takes like most of his money. And then, of course, Mika attacks him and takes the money back. It's all very crazy. But the ending of the movie is Wilson Pickett is coming to town. And this is one of the guys who Joey the Lips Fagan has said, oh, I played with Wilson Pickett. Oh, yes, yes. Can you get Wilson to come jam with us? Oh, of course I can. I can talk to him. And of course you're watching. You're like, okay, you know what? You know where this is going, right?
Yeah. And of course, that's further kind of inflamed when he goes to the hotel with Jimmy and he's like, no, I got to go in by myself. He doesn't want to see anybody else.
Yeah. Joey the Lips is like, you know, We have a bit of a interesting relationship. Like, I really need to go talk to him by myself. There's some stuff we need to work out. And Jimmy is like, all right, man, I'm sold. Whatever. Nobody else believes it, but I'm going to give you the benefit of the doubt. He goes out, and I think is one of the darkest but funniest scenes is he goes out to get this reporter who is at the moment reporting on a horse that's been shot in the middle of like a crazy like gunfight or something.
Well, it was a bank robbery and the horse got caught in the crossfire. The
scene opens with like this horse corpse, and then you see this reporter like taking notes, and you're like, where is this going? And then he's like, yeah, come report on our show. Like, Wilson Pickett's gonna be there. He's gonna come jam with us. And
because he says to the guy, he says, wait, I thought you did music reviews. And he goes, not covering horse accidents. And he's like, yeah, I do that. Crime, music, whatever else. You know.
Whatever's available, right? Mm. It's like everyone else in this town. They take the job that's there at the ready.
That's right.
But yeah, so the big thing is they're building up to this performance where Wilson Pickett is going to show up. Of course he doesn't show up.
No.
And Deco slags Jimmy on stage by saying, you know, our manager fucked up, so we're just going to sing one of Wilson Pickett's songs. And they start singing Midnight Hour. Yep.
Rousing rendition of that song. Great song.
Oh, it's great. And the performances in this movie, the musical performances are fantastic. Mm-hmm. And what I think is really interesting, too, just before that scene, is the band is having this vicious fight with each other. Like, the three girls hate each other because they all slept with Joey the Lips. Everybody hates Deco because he's talking about joining another band. People are just not getting along. And then as soon as they go on stage, it's like that fake stage persona of like, yeah, we're together. And that was that rang so true to me because I've seen that happen in wrestling, Jason. I've seen tag team partners fucking hate each other backstage, go out there and look like poetry in motion.
And that's you know, and that is reflective of a true professionalism in a person, that they can put aside their, you know, differences and go out and wrestle or do whatever. And I mean, certainly the most classic example of that was Shawn Michaels and Bret Hart, that really didn't like each other at all, legit, and still managed to go out and put on, you know, some of the greatest wrestling matches of all time.
Yeah, exactly. So, I mean, they go out there and they're performing and they do the Wilson Pickett song. And then the dark ending of this movie is Jimmy gets them a record deal. And yeah, you're like, oh, wow, this is going to end with them getting a record deal. Like, that seems like a really upbeat, kind of out of the norm ending for this type of movie.
Certainly in 1991, with 2021 eyes, the idea of a band taking a record deal, I'm left with the idea that, ooh, oh no, they're going to be dragged through the system and ground up and spit out, and they're not going to have anything to show for it. Ooh. But in 1991, if you wanted to be, you know, a famous musician, that's what you had to do if you wanted to get music out there.
Yeah, and I mean, if this record deal was coming 35 minutes into the movie, I would totally be like, oh no, this is not going to end well. But at this point, yes, I'm like, okay, we're almost done at this point. Yeah. This is going to be an uplifting ending.
It was like Wayne's World. Mr. Big shows up, and he sees the show, and they give him the record deal.
But then the band just explodes. And
literally.
People hate.
Into fire.
Everybody hates everyone. I mean, Micah literally headbutts Deco and causes him to bleed and hits him with a garbage can,
there's a good chance that if we didn't have like kind of the wrap up at the end of the movie, we could have assumed that Deco had died, because he just beats the fuck out of him.
He beats the fuck out of Deco, and then the best moment is after he's recovering and some girl is checking on him and saying, "Oh, are you okay? Oh yeah, thank you. Oh, can I have your autograph?"
Yeah,
like immediately after she finds out he's okay, but. So Jimmy is like, well, he's never going to give us this deal now. Fuck everyone. And he leaves. And then as he's leaving, Jason, a limo passes by and he says, hey, this guy says, hey, do you know where the club is at? He's like, yeah, it's over there, but it's closed down. He says, the guy turns over and says, well, Mr. Pickett, do you just want to turn around? And they turn around. So Wilson Pickett was going to go to the club. Now, mm-hmm. my question is, Jason, I have a yes. theory about this. Because sure. you could say, oh, Joey the Lips was right all along. And he actually was going to get Wilson Pickett. But do you think that's the case? Or my theory is that this band had gotten enough local fame that Wilson Pickett may have just heard of them while he was in town.
It's certainly possible. I mean, I feel like at that point, that is put there to maybe put you back on the side that Joey is legit. But then at the end of the movie, when we kind of figure out what is going on, we are told that he sent a postcard to his mother, that he was on tour with a specific artist whose name I don't remember.
Joe Tex, who had died in 1982.
1982, 9 years before this movie takes place. Yes. So yeah. We don't right? know, man. We don't yeah, know. No. He's just that good a flim flam artist, I guess.
I love that because that throws the whole thing into like confusion. Like, oh, wait, maybe not. Maybe that was just a coincidence, right?
Who could have imagined, Brendan, who could have imagined in their wildest dreams that the religious guy would be a scammer?
Right? Oh, he is religious, too. He's got that bent to him, too, doesn't he?
He's got the cross earrings. He's on a mission from God.
Well, I do like... Thank you. Nice Dan Aykroyd. I do like how he says to... I think maybe you mentioned it earlier, but he's like, oh, I received a message from God that you boys were in trouble. And when I say God, I mean the pastor over in Harlem.
Yeah. Although, interestingly, Brendan, here's an interesting detail that I noticed that lends some credence to his story, or okay. it lends credence to the theory that he's a complete psycho when it comes to the details of his grift. He's wearing a T-shirt, and you don't see the whole T-shirt because he's wearing a vest over it. But if you look close, the T-shirt he's wearing says Jesse Jackson 88. Jesse Jackson ran for president for the Democratic nomination in 1988. Obviously, it was a big deal in the black community. And that's the T-shirt he's wearing, which says, like, okay, he may have been in Harlem and gotten that T-shirt. You know, it makes sense. You know, he said he was in the U.S. for a few years and whatever else. So that's a weird little detail that contributes, I think, to the argument that he is legit.
Yeah.
But, I mean, I don't know where you would have gotten a T-shirt like that in England. In Ireland. Excuse me.
I think he was in America. I do believe that he was in America. I do believe that. Now, what he did in America is up for debate. I think that T-shirt detail is interesting. I never even noticed that. But I think, like, and again, I'll say this again. I think his performance, Johnny Murphy, is maybe my favorite in the entire film, next to Andrew Strong as Deco Cuff. I think they're two of the most interesting characters in this movie.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
But, oh, one thing I just wanted to note about the actual performances. So I don't know if you noticed this, but when they're doing, like, when they're showing, like, the live performances, they feel a lot more live, I think, than most movies. Because, like, in most movies, you know, you have the ADR over them, and it feels a little more fabricated. And what they did with this is they actually used out-of-phase speakers, which kind of enabled them to play pre-recorded tracks at maximum volume. And because of that, it kind of created this live performance atmosphere. And then each song was then recorded onto a 24-track recorder.
Okay.
So they went the extra mile to, like, they still did the thing, you know, where they're pre-recording the tracks and playing them, quote unquote, playing them in front of a live audience, but then going that extra step to kind of make it sound more genuine.
Yeah, because if you're getting a recording of the sound coming through the speakers, it's definitely going to sound more real than if it were just like a direct audio track onto the film.
Yeah, exactly. And it has that real feel. Another example of a modern movie like that, where they actually did record, like, live, and take that recording, as A Star Is Born.
Bradley Cooper version. I think they might have done that with Les Mis as well.
Yes, I think that's true. I think they actually did take the audio directly from the set. But here's the crazy thing. So, you know, there's a lot of big songs in this movie, a lot of big popular songs. Sure, so yeah. they basically told Alan Parker, you're going to have to make a short list of 1,000 song choices, because we can't get them all.
No.
And from those 1,000 choices, he had to narrow down his choices to 75 songs. And then the finished movie features 68 different musical cues and 52 songs.
That's crazy.
24 songs were chosen by the director to be performed by the cast.
That's a lot of music.
1,000, Jason.
Yeah.
Well,
you got to do what you got to do to save money.
That's right. Well, I mean, I think at this point, do you want to just take a little break and collect your bits and bobs?
I will do that.
Okay. Well, we're going to take a brief break. We're going to hear from some Age of Radio sponsors, and we will be right back.
Age of Radio.
Four Pillar Sports, a podcast for sports fans. Made by sports fans. Join Chris and Randy every week as they dive deep into football, basketball, baseball, and professional wrestling. Catch Four Pillar Sports on all major platforms. And remember, keep on talking sports.
The great visionary leader of India, Mahatma Gandhi, said, "It is health that is real wealth, and not pieces of gold and silver." Listen to the Healthy Grocer radio show on your favorite podcast platform. We know that health is our greatest wealth, and we will be discussing all aspects of natural healing. Explore everything from supplements, superfoods, and healthy lifestyle choices to help conquer stress and boost productivity. Top industry experts and natural health professionals join us for a deep dive into our healing journey. You can find the Healthy Grocer radio show on demand every day, wherever you listen to your favorite podcasts. And remember, health is your greatest wealth.
Bits and bobs, it's time for bits and bobs, it's Jason's bits and bobs, so listen to his bits and bobs.
Listen to them now, and if you don't, you're going to end up in a casket, you fucking don't.
All right. Here we go. Bits and bobs. Right out of the gate, this movie has energy, Brendan, and I like it. Yeah. I like the music right off the bat. I like that it literally starts with the line, "I want to tell you a story." I think that's the perfect way to start every movie. This movie shot in the 4:3 aspect ratio. I think that was that called Academy Flat at one time or something like that, Academy Standard, or I don't know. But old TV shape, and it was a little bit jarring at first. It's been a while since I watched the movie 4:3, but it was nice. It was nice.
Did you also notice that this starts off with the most irresponsible mass gathering?
Yes, certainly. Flea market. Yeah, Jesus Christ.
Guys, so come people. On, wear a mask.
I forgot about flea markets. I love flea markets. And this was at a time when flea markets were still cool because the internet didn't exist, so nobody knew what they had, so you could get really good deals and fuck people over.
Yep.
Ah, those are the days. At the wedding, dude's playing the guitar and he's using the beer glass as a slide. I like that. That's a nice little...
Oh, yeah, that was a good detail.
Good little detail and what I'm sure many bar guitarists have done in their lives. Some more fat shaming in this movie when, of course, the little chubby girl is the one that is stuffing her face with dessert. Couldn't be a skinny kid stuffing her face. No, it's got to be little fatty, of course.
Are you saying that Alan Parker was a Lavender Hill Mob fan?
That's right. I'm saying he was. He was inspired directly, and this fat shaming will not continue under my watch.
Oh, there's a great line here where someone says they're talking about band names, and I think it's Glen Hansard who says, "Well, that band Free Beer always gets a great crowd."
That's a good line.
Yeah.
At one point, somebody's singing a song in the pub, and they say the line that sounded like "From Westeros," which is from Game of Thrones, to Nova Scotia. That was not what he said. I guess he says from Wester Ross to Nova Scotia, but I just heard the name Nova Scotia, so it made me happy because that's where I'm from.
So, Jason, I've got a question. If David Schwimmer was in Game of Thrones, what character would he play?
Oh, Wester Ross. Hey, we were on a break, right? That's Ross, right?
Sure.
I didn't watch a whole lot of Friends.
He was very sad. And as it turns out, as we watch Friends in retrospect, definitely the worst person.
It was really funny at the time, and it's still funny now, but for different reasons.
Yeah, not a good human being, and also kind of homophobic.
Yeah, yeah. But that was the 90s for you, right?
There you go.
Let's see. That cool bike riding scene through the neighborhood is kind of indicative to me of how cool this movie looks. Like, I love all the buildings. I love the setting, shots of Dublin. Like, the texture is really good, and you get a real sense of the place. With the
good montages. Good montages.
Very good montages.
I like that one guy who, we didn't talk about all of the characters, but the one guy who's playing he's playing the saxophone. And he stops and looks at a bunch of kids gathered around. He says, "I'm black and I'm proud."
Yes.
And the kid gives him a look like, the fuck?
Yeah. yeah, funny in 91, maybe less funny now, but still kind of strange.
I think the movie is aware that it's a ridiculous line to say.
Very ridiculous, for sure. Yeah. There's no question. So he gets a massive response to that newspaper ad.
Mm.
Like, there must be so little going on in North Dublin that he puts little ad in the paper to start a band, and everybody comes. He's literally got a line out the door at one point of people wanting to audition for this band.
People all crowded on the stairs.
Yeah, and I can't imagine he had any promise of actual money in this situation. So they're all there just because they want to be in a band.
Did you like Billy the drummer when he's asked about his influences? He says it's Animal from the Muppets.
Well, it's funny you mentioned that because that's what I thought that Micah was basically, was Animal from the Muppets in human form.
You're probably not wrong. You're not wrong.
Oh, and the saxophone guy, when he shows up to audition, he's talking about the saxophone. He's always played long. He goes, "Oh, no, I haven't had the saxophone long. My uncle gave it to me when his lung collapsed."
Yes, and then he says, and I have, it's not him, but there's another character. Oh, it's the drummer that says, "I can practice all the time because my dad is dead and all my brothers are younger, so no one tells me to fuck off."
Yep.
this movie is a hard R. They say
F-bombs.
Fuck like over 100 times.
I think Bernie might say it the most. And every time she says it, I was absolutely tickled. let's see here. So we also have that recurring bit where Jimmy is interviewing himself. We first see him doing it in the very beginning of the movie.
Yes. Maybe? And he keeps saying Terry, and I don't remember who this was, but Terry something is like a famous interviewer in the UK at the time.
Okay. All right. Yeah. Makes sense. Let's see. I just really like this shot when he goes in to see, I think, Deco for the first time, and he walks through this bus wash because Deco's on lunch from his job as a bus conductor. And I just really like the framing of it. It was just a really cool, as he just walks through the bus wash. It's a tiny thing. Resonated with me. I don't know.
I also like the fence saying that, "Why would you even bother playing music? Everything is shite since Roy Orbison died."
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. I feel you. That was a sad time. When Joey shows up, "The Lord sent me and the Lord blows my trumpet," which I thought was a funny line. and then Jimmy is talking to his
As I say, also, Jason, what does he tell the other, what does he tell the saxophonist to pretend when you're playing the saxophone?
Yeah, he says, I'm glad you remembered that because I was going to mention that.
Okay.
He tells him to pretend it's a nipple of a lady. And then he's like, okay. And he's like, well, who's your lady? He's like, well, it's this girl across the street that I kind of have a crush on, but she's still in school, so I feel bad about it. And so he settles on Kim Basinger.
Does he say that?
I think so, yeah.
Oh, wow. I didn't miss that completely.
I think that was who he said. Kim Basinger. Oh. Yeah. So, yeah, that's how he plays the saxophone, and that adds a whole other layer to that. Mm-hmm. And so when Jimmy's talking to his dad about Joey, he's like, well, who's that guy? And he's like, God sent him. And he looks at him for a second. He goes, on a fucking Suzuki?
Great line. There's so many funny lines, like one-liners in this movie.
It's good.
How about the twins? The twin sisters of Jimmy, played by real twins.
Which, of course, have to both say the exact same thing at the exact same time, because they're clearly creepy ghost twins.
I love it.
Somebody saw The Shining and thought, let's do that.
Let's make that a comedy.
That's right. Soul can solve the troubles, I wrote down, because I think they seem to think that their music can possibly stop the troubles, so that's good.
Yeah.
I hope so. I'm holding out for them.
All right. I'm not going to say anything.
Spoiler alert, I haven't got to 1998 yet.
in your chronological news reading?
I started Wikipedia at the earliest year available, and we're going through year by year. Let's see here. When they go into the church and dude's playing Whiter Shade of Pale on the organ, I thought that was good. And then, of course, they get caught by the priest and they're like, oh, no. And he's like, oh, yeah, no, I like that song. That's good. Sounds good. Yeah. It's a weird line. And then that goes when the guy goes into the confession and he's talking about something and he says something about a song and the priest corrects him on who sang the song. He's like, yeah, because I own the album.
Yeah, he says something like, and I've listened to something by When a Man Loves a Woman by Marvin Gaye, and the priest is like, actually, it's Percy Sledge.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. I own the album.
Yeah.
Let's see.
I will say, I'm going to say right now, in the tradition of me being a fucking person who easily cries at movies, there was a moment in this movie, and it was when they sang Dark End of the Street. For some reason, that just got me. I don't know what it was.
Oh, little Jimmy Pardo over here crying his eyes out.
You know what part I'm talking about, right?
I'm not sure. Refresh
me. He's like at the dark end of the street.
Okay. Yeah, it didn't resonate with me in the same way.
When Deco says, I'm going to play something a little slower for all my fans.
Right, because they make fun of him for saying that.
Yeah.
His fans.
Oh, yeah, he's a prick. Anyway.
When they do that gig at the anti-drug... thing, and they have the banner that says heroin kills, but they spell heroin with an E.
With an E, and then
lady hero.
what do they do? They like blank it out after.
Yeah, they like cover it up. You can still see it, but it's covered up. So, yeah.
And I love how the priest is like, I like the addition of the needle though.
Yeah, exactly.
The needle's a good Dutch.
He's such a wonderful, wonderfully diplomatic priest. A pair of Y fronts gets tossed on stage. We know them here in North America as briefs, but I thought it appropriate to use the British term, which I thought was funny. They blow the stage up at one point when was it Deco catches the mic on the guitar or something, and he falls back, and then there's an explosion, and he comes into the hospital, and he's completely fucking covered in blood. Like, it's pretty gory.
So just before we go any further, and I know we played a few clips, but I do want to play a clip right here, now that you mentioned it, because after this whole explosion, they're waiting in the hospital to see if he's going to be okay, the guitarist, and they have this little discussion, which I thought was pretty funny.
If Derek dies, will he be famous?
What are you talking about?
It's a sure way to get famous. Die on a stage, get shot in a motel, we'd sell millions of records.
I still don't understand what happened.
You have to keep the juice from the amps and the mic separate. Derek was the earth there for a minute.
Isn't that how the guy from AC/DC died?
No, he choked in his own vomit. Started your man from Free, didn't he? Yeah, lots of them.
Yeah. Keith Moon.
Jimi Hendrix.
Brian Jones.
Nah, he drowned.
Did he?
Yeah. Mama Cass.
That was vomit.
Vomit.
That was a heart attack,
wasn't
it?
No.
Maybe we could get Deco to choke on his own vomit.
I all I could think of, Brendan, watching that scene was from Spinal Tap when they're, he choked on vomit. It was not his vomit, It was vomit. I mean, we may never know. I mean, you can't dust for vomit, can you?
And it's one of the few references to drugs, because drugs don't really play a factor in this movie.
I guess that and the heroin kills thing, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, because they say, oh, and then, of course, you get the band hating Deco, because they're like, well, maybe Deco will choke on his own vomit.
Yeah, maybe. The drummer quit because he rightfully hated the singer. I already said that. I loved Micah, the security guard / drummer, all the way through. His headbutts were super brutal, and he did a lot of damage every time he did it. When he fucks up that fence at the end of the movie, though, I thought, this isn't going to be good. And then we never see that come back around to bite Jimmy. So I assume that if in the snapper or the van, Jimmy gets murdered by this guy.
I don't think any of the other characters come back, aside from Colm Meaney. But I do like that Jimmy and Natalie end up hooking up. We hear about that in the voiceover.
Good for them. Yeah. Very happy.
And Micah is the lead singer of a successful band, apparently.
Hmm. Have to be like a punk band, I imagine.
Well, yeah. Do you remember that? And it's like the whole, like, where are these characters now montage.
Yeah, the animal house ending, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Yes, of course. Make sure when you go to Universal Studios, ask for Babs, is what they say.
Yeah. And that's pretty much all I have there for notes that I haven't already talked about. All right. This has been Jason's Bits and Bobs.
And or Bobs.
Bobs.
Well, Jason, I'm going to tell you this. We're going to get to the awards here that this thing garners up. It doesn't win an Oscar, but it is nominated for one Oscar.
Oh, very nice.
You want to take adventure as to what it gets nominated for?
Best soundtrack.
No.
Best sound design.
No.
Best screenplay.
No.
Adapted. Oh, best cinematography.
No. Best editing. It gets nominated for, which I'll say right now, I think deservedly so, because I think the opening, especially the opening when they're cutting between songs and they're cutting in like the middle of different songs back and forth, like that's done extremely well. But the winner that year for editing, probably rightfully so, was JFK.
Oh yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, yeah. It does win a few BAFTAs. It is nominated also for a few BAFTAs. So the ones it doesn't win but is nominated for, and this is a cool one, it's nominated for Best Supporting Actor for Andrew Strong, who plays Deco. But the winner that year is Alan Rickman for Robin Hood, Prince of Thieves.
Nice.
It is also nominated for Best Sound, which is won by Terminator 2. And it wins, here we go, Jason, these are the big ones that it wins at the BAFTAs. Best Editing, Best Adapted Screenplay, Best Director for Alan Parker, and Best Overall Film.
Hmm.
This film was the highest grossing film in Ireland of all time, despite it not doing super well in the U.S. In the U.S., so the movie cost between $12 and $15 million. It only ended up getting about $14.9 million, so not amazing. However, it did receive mostly positive reviews. Even the author of the book, Roddy Doyle, said that the filmmakers did a terrific job, which is very refreshing to hear. Yeah. The original author liking an adaptation of their work.
I suppose it was probably helpful, too, that he helped write the script and must have been involved in some meaningful way rather than just having his name put there.
Yeah, I think he helped produce it for sure. Variety magazine said the movie was well executed and original. Roger Ebert said the film was filled with life and energy and the music is honest. However, Siskel did not care for it as much. Gene said it was a joyful but empty mixture of Irish kids and Black American soul music. Owen Gleiberman of the Entertainment Weekly was even more harsh, saying the overall premise was downright insulting. And said, in Parker's hands, soul music becomes little more than a self-serving metaphor, an easy symbol for commitment and integrity. And then, you know, there's some negative reviews here as well. Janet Maslin of the New York Times says the commitment becomes repetitive after a while, since so much of it is about the group's stage show. And since the effort to create an offstage story never really works. David Denby said it has a raspy surface authenticity and a great deal of affection for its characters and milieu, but not enough dramatic interest. So there's very mixed reviews at the time. However, since that time, it has been hailed as a favorite. And one of the, I think it's pretty much across the board, one of the best Irish films of all time. So I will ask you this, Jason.
Sure.
What'd you think?
I enjoyed this movie. I did. If this movie didn't have as much music in it, it probably could stand to be shorter, but I think the music is good and it really keeps the flow going through this movie. Like, there's never too long between music, so that really kind of keeps the flow of, as I say, the flow of the movie going, and I enjoyed it. Would I say it's my favorite musical movie like this ever made? No. I might even say I like A Hard Day's Night a little more, but I enjoyed it very much, and you can't argue, the music is fantastic and everybody's very good in the movie, and with lots of characters to enjoy. So yeah, no, it's definitely worth a watch. I do recommend it.
So better than Rockstar?
I never did actually see Rockstar. It's just more of a punchline in my mind.
You don't need to.
No, I didn't think so.
I'm a sucker for a music heavy film. And this was definitely one of those. And it was great music, soul music. Oh, yeah. I love soul music. It was fantastic. Mm-hmm. And the performances all feel real. That's the thing about this movie. Like, it's obviously a very Hollywood-esque movie, but the performances feel genuine. Everybody feels like they're portraying a character. It probably helps that these are not, like, major actors. That probably helps the authenticity of the whole thing,
and that the whole enterprise sort of fails at the end gives it almost a Rocky like quality, where it didn't work out, but what a ride it was, you know.
It didn't work out, and we get that montage of like where everyone went after the movie, and not everyone achieves fame, and some people do better than others, and you know, and there's that great quote at the end of the movie where Jimmy looks in the mirror and says and starts quoting what is that song? Whiter Shade of Pale, right?
Yeah.
He starts quoting Whiter Shade of Pale. He's like, it's something the light, Fandango, whatever that line is. And then he has Terry say, well, what does that mean, Jimmy? That's very profound. And he says, the fuck if I know, Terry? And that's the last line of the movie.
Yeah.
And that's just very charming that the movie ends with like, I don't know what it all means. Fuck it.
Nice punch. Yeah.
Yeah. So, I mean, and it's 38 on the list, and maybe that's a little bit higher than I would put it, but I think it deserves its place on this list just because of its entertainment value alone. I was never bored, for sure.
No, not at all.
And it's got this status as this great piece of Irish filmmaking. Like, it's got this legendary label on it. So, yes, I loved this movie. I loved this movie.
Good. I'm glad.
But now comes the time. Jason and I are remote right now, so we have to get creative here. But we're going to quote unquote roll the dice. Jason, what have you got for a dice there?
Well, I typed virtual dice into Google, and Google has a virtual dice tool, so that's what I'm going to use.
Okay, so Jason is going to use a virtual dice, and we are going to find out what movie on the BFI Top 100 that we are going to talk about next week by way of a virtual dice roll. So, right. Jason, if you will, roll that dice.
Here we go. 27.
27 is Dr. Zhivago. We've already done Dr. Zhivago. That was our first episode.
We watched it, and we watched a remake. We don't need to do it again. Here we go, number two.
Okay.
Number two, 86.
86. We have done Genevieve. It was a fun little movie.
That wasn't too bad. Yeah, fun little car picture. All right, here we go again. And we have 18.
18. We have already done Henry V.
One more time. Here we go.
I don't know about that. 98. Okay, Jason, we're going to stay in the 90s here.
All right.
98, we're going to watch a film from 1995, directed by Gillies McKinnon, is a movie called Small Faces.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I don't
know. There's a song by Oysterhead called Little Faces, so I wonder if it's related.
I don't know. I know absolutely nothing about this movie.
Me neither.
Small Faces. We're going to talk about it next week. God damn, Jason, 98. You were so close to picking Carry On Up the Khyber.
I know. I was so close.
Fucking blew it. So that's what we're going to talk about next week. But until then, you can find us on social media. You can find us on Twitter at @BFI_pod. You can find us on Facebook. Just search for Four Screen.
And Country.
You can find us at our home base at Age of Radio, ageofradio.org/Four Screen and Country. Or just go to ageofradio.org and check us out that way and listen to some other podcasts. There's some great people on there. And you can find Jason on Twitter.
You can follow me at Jason D. McLeod. That's M-A-C-L-E-O-D. Come by, follow me. It would be so nice to see myself getting followed by somebody who wasn't a porn bot. So that'd be really cool. I got two more. So I wonder if there's like a new porn bot tech, because it'd been a long time since a porn bot had followed me, but now two of them did. So
it's been a while since porn bots followed Jason.
They don't want to follow me, and I feel sad.
Well, you know what, Jason? Maybe you just need to form a band.
That's right. That's right. I can't sing, so I'm going to have to be the manager.
You have to be the Jimmy of the group.
That's right. Just call me Jimmy John.
and yeah, until next week when we talk about the film Small Faces, I guess I just have to say to you, God save the Queen.
God save the screen.
And for Screen and Country, I'm Brendan.
And I'm Jason.
Try a little tenderness.
Oh, yeah. Try it.
In games that never amount to more than their